In the 80s and early 90s, fighting games as we know them today hadn't yet become an established genre, so most academics and gamers cite 1984's Karate Champ as the true birth of the one-on-one fighter. However, within the realm of pop culture, the game is widely regarded as being one of the worst fighting games ever made. In 1990, Atari Games published Pit Fighter, a standout title for the time that featured digitized actors battling it out in a photorealistic environment. The game didn't do particularly well, but a young John Tobias saw an opportunity to improve upon the idea whilst working on pinball machines for Midway and got to work on an idea that would change the genre forever. Drawing upon inspiration from his favourite movies, Tobias envisioned a fighting game targeted specifically at adults that use photorealistic characters and settings. He cherry-picked his favourite characters, film plots, and special effects and dropped the concept for what would become Mortal Kombat. Despite only having access to a relatively small budget, costumes from a local party shop and a studio converted from an unused warehouse became the backdrop of the soon-to-be game. Tobias and Boone used what they had and painstakingly created a demo of the game after work and on weekends. For background research, the pair played every other fighting game on the market and decided the best course of action was to make the game as different as possible from Street Fighter II, the dominant game in the arcades during the era. In place of traditional sprites for the characters, the game utilized animated segments of real actors performing the moves for the game in costume to give the title its unique look. After a successful pitch to the board of directors at Midway, Tobias and Boone gathered a group of martial artist friends to sit down and create one of the most shocking and groundbreaking fighting games of all time, to immediate critical acclaim. The overwhelmingly positive reception of the game would quickly turn the title into a franchise, with a series of movies, sequels, toys, trading cards, action figures, and famously, the Immortals would produce the legendary theme song Techno Syndrome to accompany the game's movie. That's what it's all about. Uncompromising competitive combat with the intent to kill or be killed. No more knockouts. It's about pulling someone's heart out and watching them die. There is nothing more 90s than witnessing Scorpion shout, as you wage war against Sub-Zero in a fight to the death. Mortal Kombat is the first fighting game, in my opinion, that feels larger than the game itself. It's a gruesome, voyeuristic spectacle in which the graphics on screen beautifully represent the mental competition you share between the player next to you in the real world. I absolutely love it. Mortal Kombat is legendary for its outrageous use of violence, in particular its finishing moves, or
fatality.
With a secret button combination, players could humiliate their opposition at the end of a fight, adding further insult to injury. At the time, these graphics were state-of-the-art, and blood wasn't a common occurrence yet in video games, so you can imagine the shock of seeing someone's head being torn off with their spinal cord still attached right next to the 2P machines. The plot of the game is fairly simple and was designed in such a way that the plot didn't really have to matter, but provided enough context on screen to make the fighting have a purpose. 500 years ago, the evil sorcerer Shang Tsung was banished to Earthrealm and used the power of the dragon warrior Goro to seize control of the legendary Mortal Kombat tournament, a tournament that if he won, would allow him to not only doom the Earthrealm, but also return home to wreak havoc once again. In an attempt to stop Shang Tsung and Goro, the Earthrealm sent its best fighters to participate in the tournament to stop the plan. However, it soon discovered that all of the fighters arrive on the island and are out to win for their own ends, thus carnage ensues. Prior to dropping a coin in the machine, you can see a variety of attract screens that provide small amounts of backstory for each character. Despite the quality being very low, these little clips were groundbreaking for the time for providing full motion video in a game. You might even catch a glimpse of the fearsome sub-boss Goro, the only character in the game to be hand-modelled and animated. After inserting your coin and picking a fighter from the 7 available, you're given a battle plan that shows you exactly who Shang Tsung has pitted you against and in what order. Each time you play, the game changes, meaning that you have to adjust your strategy every time you play the game. Personally, Sonya Blade is my favourite character. She is a complete dark horse and has an utterly devastating combo move that, if frame counted correctly, can stop your opponent ever getting up and defending themselves. If you were able to complete the game, you would treat it to a brief resolution to the character's story arc. My favourite is Raiden's, who despite entering the tournament to save the day, actually finds the whole event too easy and simply returns to his day after murdering everyone. What a guy! Here's a fun fact. Originally, Tobias and Boom wanted Van Damme to be in the game, but communications broke down halfway through, so they put in a lookalike and called him Johnny Cage, and kept the famous crotch punch from the movie Bloodsport in to honour their favourite action star. So really, you're playing as a parody of kind of a parody the entire time. Mixed in between the challenges is a bonus challenge called Test Your Might. The goal is to break whichever object has been placed in front of you by hitting the punch buttons as fast as possible and then striking. These sections serve as a good opportunity to gain some bonus points and make it even further on the high scores once the game is over. The gameplay of Mortal Kombat is fairly typical of the genre today, making it very easy to pick up and understand. Battles take place over the best of three rounds, and as you'd expect, fighters can jump, block, throw, and utilize character-specific moves in order to win the match. I find Mortal Kombat to be the best old-school fighting game to introduce my friends to, as the controls are incredibly easy to learn. Mortal Kombat popularized the use of its unique 5-button control scheme that made approaching the game so much easier, and it remains the same today. Every character's base moves are exactly the same, so it's really just a matter of learning the special button combinations for each character the one time and then being done with it. This makes the game so much more accessible, especially as most characters only have 2 or 3 moves to learn, so when you've got one, you've basically got them all. The immediate accessibility of the game encourages players to come up with creative ways to master potential of all the characters. For instance, you can create your own combos against the walls, combos in the air known as juggles, and so much more when you understand exactly the right time to perform an action or a special move. A feature I love is that the game sneakily learns how you play and uses your own strategies against you the further you progress. This forces you to master several characters at once and switch up your playstyle to outsmart the computer and actually see the ending. This gameplay feature is especially cool on the most famous stage, the Pit, which allows enemies to be thrown off from the top onto the spikes below. There is nothing more satisfying than pulling off the perfect comeback to win in such a gruesome way. Another cool feature is that during the third mirror match, the music will actually quieten down so you can hear the sub-boss Goro approaching. If you win the fight, he will then jump out and challenge you immediately. This is an excellent way to build suspense, especially in an arcade-like setting. If you are able to challenge and defeat Goro, Shang Tsung himself appears and reveals himself as the final boss. He can transform into any character on the fly, deals twice the amount of damage, and has screen-clearing attacks. He is truly a difficult boss. I think I spent more time trying to beat him than the rest of the game combined. It's even harder than the endurance stages, where you have to take down 2 opponents consecutively, twice. If you can defeat him though, you will feel on top of the world and will be treated to the credits and an epilogue of the character you chose to play as. I also think it's pretty crazy that despite there being 7 characters to play as, most of them are played by the exact same human actor. In fact, Liu Kang the hero and Shang Tsung the villain are the exact same person, just in a different costume. Generally speaking, Mortal Kombat is considered a classic in the video game industry and isn't just a Street Fighter 2 clone that many people consider it to be. Like with all industries, eventually blood, gore, and sex makes its way to the platform in question, and in this case it actually helped mature the attitude of the industry towards quote-unquote adult games.
Mortal Kombat and Night Trap are not the kind of gifts that responsible parents give.
Infamously, in 1993, the US Senate hearing chaired by Joseph Lieberman addressed the ballooning violence in certain games, and Mortal Kombat, among others, took the heat. This brought into question if violence should be allowed in video games at all.
Instead of enriching a child's mind, these games teach a child to enjoy inflicting torture.
The result of this case was the introduction of the ESRB, a standardized legal way to address what kind of consumer could access what kind of game, essentially stopping little Jimmy from walking into a Walmart and buying anything he wanted.
We now require warning labels on toys that can potentially damage children's bodies. Why not do so on a toy that can damage their minds?
Hilariously though, the Senate became the ultimate advert for the games on trial. How do you make kids want something they can't have? Get the ultimate authority on it to complain about it and say you can't have it.
The rating system must not be perverted into a cynical marketing ploy to attract children to more violent games. A rating system without some industry self-regulation may put us just where we don't want to be. We must not allow the industry to trumpet a violent rating as a selling point.
The Senate hearings only demonstrated even more that Mum and Dad wouldn't approve of the adult-themed games, which ultimately landed them at the top of every Christmas list.
Down with this sort of thing!
Careful now.
Down with this sort of thing!
This case actually kind of reminds me of the scene in Father Ted, where the church decides the film on Craggy Island is too rude for its followers.
You wouldn't believe the amount of nudity in it.
All that happens is that the authority alerts the people who otherwise didn't care into seeing what they weren't allowed to be seeing. In fact, it's quite telling of the situation.
Simply put, we are no longer asking whether violent video games may cause harm to our children, especially to our young children. Clearly they can.
If it wasn't for games like Mortal Kombat, we probably wouldn't have titles such as Doom, Resident Evil, or Grand Theft Auto, all titles which have sold in the millions and have turned the perception of video games as just toys into a concept of the past. So really, we can be thankful for the decapitations and puncture wounds after all. Mortal Kombat also takes the accolade for having the first secret character ever in a video game. The green-clad ninja reptile can be found if a player spots silhouettes passing the moon in the background of the pit stage and can win both rounds flawlessly, without blocking, and perform their character's fatality in one clean run. Yeah, it's pretty much impossible. If you can fulfill the shopping list of conditions required, you are taken to a secret level where you can fight Reptile, who has the moveset of both Scorpion and Sub-Zero, moves faster than every other character, and as a bonus Easter egg, you can find impaled heads of the game's designers found throughout the stage. It's pretty cool. Interestingly enough, Reptile isn't technically the only hidden character in the game. There is a second character dubbed as Ermac by the fans. In the game order options, only usually accessible to arcade owners or repair service people, a listing can be found for Ermac within the character selection statistics. Photos of the screen eventually made their way to the press, and players naturally assumed that alongside Reptile, a hidden character called Ermac was somewhere within the game. In 1993, Electronic Gaming Monthly posted a hoax in the October issue to perpetuate the story that Ermac was somewhere within the game. They did this by editing a blurry image of Scorpion to have a red outfit and passing off as the real character. John Tobias and Ed Boon were so amazed at both the hoax and the ingenuity of fans that Ermac was actually canonized into the game and made fully playable in Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3, complete with special moves and fatalities. Ermac was so well received that it's become a mainstay of the series ever since. Despite being innovative for the time, Mortal Kombat does have its fair share of exploits and glitches that the developers oversaw in the game's short development cycle. For instance, Johnny Cage on rare occasions is actually able to decapitate his opponent twice, and Sonya can stop Raiden getting back into battle by consistently sweeping in a very specific location during the endurance rounds. It's also possible to perform a fatality so quickly that it misses the target entirely, leaving both fighters standing there looking a bit lost.
Flawless victory. Fatality.
Whilst we're on the topic, I'd like to discuss Mortal Kombat sequels as they have helped cement the franchise into the mainstream. Now of course you have the home versions that appeared on platforms such as the Sega Mega Drive, Super Nintendo and MS-DOS. Some had blood, some didn't, it was kind of a mixed bag, but I'd like to carry on with the next arcade iteration for now. Less than 12 months after Mortal Kombat's release, Mortal Kombat 2 was released in 1993 to rave reviews and is generally considered as a step up in graphics, sound, and overall gameplay.
Kung Lao wins.
The plot of the game directly follows the first in the series. After Shang Tsung and Gore have been defeated, Shao Kahn, the real baddie, gives Shang Tsung one final chance to win the tournament, threatening to execute him if he fails.
Round one, fight!
Mortal Kombat 2 is notable for a few key aspects. The graphics, sound, and animation are far superior to the first game. Everything feels smoother, runs better, and comes across as a much more fluid experience. Mortal Kombat 2 offers more characters to select, more fatalities, fatalities, and even friendships.
Friendship?
A new type of finishing move deliberately created to poke fun at the controversy caused by the US Supreme Court hearings and quote-unquote, upset parents. The only characters missing from the roster from the previous game are Sonya Blade and Kano. However, they can be seen in the background of Shao Kahn's stage as a nice little Easter egg. Complementing Reptile's legacy, Mortal Kombat 2 features three hidden characters who have their own unique way of revealing themselves in the main game, marking the first appearance of Jade, Noob Saibot, and Smoke, bundled in with a quick trip back to Goro's lair from the first game. Mortal Kombat 2 is generally considered to be the hardest in the series due to its unfair and brutal AI. However, it still remains to be one of the fan favourites because it's such a fun game. The popularity of the title resulted in two ports to the PlayStation and Saturn, and even an impressive conversion to the defunct Sega 32X. I love the stone walls that encompass the game's frame. They almost exhibit the title as a theater of death, leading the player to watch the game in a voyeuristic manner. It's a really clever design. The Pit 2 is also noteworthy for its full-screen scaling within a fatality. For me, The most important addition in Mortal Kombat 2 is the use of Dolby surround sound to create a game that sounds as shocking as it looks. For instance, take a look at this stage fatality. 23 years later, the sound still delivers the intended effect.
Let's finish him!
Dan Forden even makes his Easter egg appearance in the game, which has become a staple of the franchise ever since. To conclude, Mortal Kombat 2 is a beautiful and technically impressive game for the time, and is a true sequel to the first game, but it is relentlessly difficult and takes a lot of time to fully appreciate. In 1995, Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 was released as a follow-up to Mortal Kombat 3 that suffered with missing characters and somewhat unbalanced gameplay following internal issues at Midway. Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 was designed to completely replace Mortal Kombat 3, and does so with flying colours. It once again steps up the graphics and introduces even more fighters, stages, and a combo system that allows fighters to chain special moves and standard attacks together with an energy meter. It also allowed for online play between specialised arcade cabinets, and is considered the best game in the series by programmers John Tobias and Ed Boon. They even hid themselves in their game as the Super Sega character, Noob Saibot, which is just their names backwards. One of the coolest features of this game is its tournament mode and 2v2 option. This essentially turns the game into a FIFA 06 Sunday afternoon barbecue type affair, with players competing in teams to try and win overall. I highly recommend it. Famously, Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 was defended in the US Appeals Court as a positive feminist video game.
Well done.
Despite the controversy at the time, Judge Richard Posner stated that the game encouraged young women to engage in games typically represented and dominated by a male teenage audience, and that the female characters empowered their human players outside of the game. How cool! Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 is regarded by fans as the true ending to the franchise. By 1996, gamers were moving on to 3D graphics, most notably with games such as Tekken, Virtua Fighter 2, and Mortal Kombat 4.
Wait! This is brutality! You can't do it!
Wrong, Jarek. This is not a brutality. This is a fatality.
It seemed then that the 2D Mortal Kombat games had had their day. However, there was one last hurrah for patient gamers with a shiny new PlayStation, Saturn, or Nintendo 64. Mortal Kombat Trilogy. Essentially Super Smash Bros. Ultimate for the Mortal Kombat franchise, the title was released and provided the fan service everybody wanted. Mortal Kombat Trilogy features every stage, character, finishing move, and arcade quality sound effects and audio all on a home console. By far the coolest feature is a hidden cheat menu that allows for one-button fatalities. At the end of the fight with the cheat enabled, simply tap any button on the controller and watch what happens. It provides the instant shock value you want when playing the game without having to learn pages and pages of button combinations. If you decide to play with the actual board, the digital download, or Mortal Kombat Trilogy on the Sony PlayStation, all three versions are compatible with the plethora of fight sticks on the market today, allowing for the authentic arcade experience at home if that's what you're into. The best part about this whole situation is that the game hasn't become overly expensive. It averaged around £20 on eBay, meaning that with a classic console or PC powerful enough to emulate the game on any platform, it remains readily accessible with support for modern controllers, which is excellent. After several years of less than stellar sales, the Mortal Kombat franchise was picked up by Warner Bros. Interactive. They set out to bring the series back to what made it so awesome in the 90s, by removing unnecessary characters and plot, and giving the fans what they actually wanted. In 2011, Mortal Kombat came out for PlayStation 3, Xbox 360, and PC, and it shocked, horrified, and inspired audiences all around the globe. Spinal Tap achieved their sound by turning up to 11, Mortal Kombat did the same thing by turning the gore up to 1,000.
Kung Lao wins.
Mortal Kombat is a reimagined retelling of the first three games with updated characters, sound, and online play.
You will taste no victory.
At a glance, you can tell that love and care went into this game. Everything looks sharp, runs well, and delivers the shock value the fans expected from the franchise. The game even had a dedicated fatality team that was specifically hired to be murdered on camera in creative ways. You can tell that no expense was spared. All of the arcade costumes are selectable, and all of the original fatalities make their way back into the 3D game. Even Dan Forden makes a reappearance. The controls have also been simplified, allowing the game to be picked up quicker by newcomers, and extra time has been provided in order to perform the fatalities, all of which are welcome additions. Breakers have also been added in. If you take enough damage, you can press the triggers on your controller at the right time to help even out the life bars in close-up, disgusting combos. Mortal Kombat is awesome and you absolutely need a copy. Today, Mortal Kombat is as strong as ever. The latest iterations have even managed to get the license for Aliens, Friday the 13th, and Rambo. For me, the first Mortal Kombat will always be a classic that I turn to for some quick arcade action. Even though our standards have changed, it continues to be shocking, violent, and ahead of the curve, and that's why I love it and recommend it to all of my friends. If you're looking for the best version to play, I highly recommend the Mortal Kombat Arcade Collection on PlayStation 3. It is only available as a digital download and is currently priced at £12.99.